Morning and welcome to the 15th meeting of Session 6 of the Equalities, Human Rights and Civil Justice Committee. We have no apologies this morning. We welcome Tess White MSP to this morning's meeting, and I'm aware that a number of other MSPs will be watching live on Parliament TV or on catch-up. In our session today, the committee will continue to take evidence on the Gender Recognition Reform Scotland Bill. The responses to the detailed call for views have now been published, as have a summary of responses to the short survey. Notes of our private informal engagement sessions and the informal briefing session with the Bill team will be published shortly. As agreed at our meeting on the 15th of March, the committee will hear from the Cabinet Secretary at the conclusion of our evidence taking. Our first agenda item is to take evidence from our first panel on the Bill, which will focus on children and young people. In addition to this morning's oral evidence, we have written evidence from a number of other children and young people's organisations, which can be found on our website. So I'm pleased to welcome this morning Bruce Adamson, Children and Young People's Commissioner, Scotland, who is joining us virtually, and Ellie Gummersall, President-elect of NUS Scotland and President of the Students Association at the University of the West of Scotland. So you're both very welcome. I refer members to papers 1, 2 and 3, and if I can now invite our witnesses to make a short opening statements, starting with Bruce Adamson, please.
Thank you, Convener. Good morning, Committee. We welcome the Scottish Government's aim to simplify the process and mechanism for obtaining a... is in line with international human rights standards and practices, and we recognise the evidence from trans people about their negative experiences with existing processes. In our latest written evidence, we supplemented our previous submissions and highlighted three areas where we think the bill could be strengthened or clarified, namely clarity on the role of the Register General for Scotland, more detail on the support offered to 16 and 17-year-olds, and concerns over the introduction of a criminal offence and penalties for under-18s. Questions of identity go to the core of a person's dignity, and maintaining and respecting gender identity is one of the areas that the European Court of Human Rights has said it's one of the most intimate areas of a person's private life. In your role as human rights guarantors, the framing of this as a rights issue is important. Article 2 of the Convention on the Rights of the Child protects against discrimination, which also includes gender identity as part of other status, and puts a positive duty to actively identify children and groups of children whose realisation of rights might require special measures and protections. Article 3 requires that all matters concerning a child, their best interest should be a primary consideration. Article 6 obliges states to ensure the maximum extent possible the survival and development of the child. And the term development there is to be interpreted in the broadest possible sense, to include a child's physical, mental, spiritual, moral, psychological, and social development. And so in the context of deciding whether to provide legal recognition for the acquired gender of young people, Article 6 requires the state to consider whether providing such recognition assists in creating conditions conducive to the optimal development of the young people. And I note from the evidence that the committee has received from young trans people, particularly around barriers and participation to education and the impacts on their physical and mental health. Articles 8 and 14 cover identity and thoughts and beliefs respectively. Article 12 requires the state to provide children with the right to express their views and the due weight to be given to that in accordance with their age and maturity. And this applies both to the discussions that you'll be having and the Parliament will be having in terms of what the system should be, as well as for any individuals accessing that system. And importantly, the Committee on the Rights of the Child, in their general comment number 20 in 2016, where they focused on rights during adolescence, they identified lesbian, gay, bisexual, transgender, and intersex adolescents as a group requiring particular attention in order for the realisation of their rights to occur. And in that same general comment, the committee strongly endorsed the rights of adolescents to respect for their emerging autonomy. Article 16 of the Convention provides the right for privacy, home and correspondence, and it's analogous to Article 17 of the International Covenant on Civil and Political Rights and Article 8 of the European Convention on Human Rights, which have played a central role in establishing gender recognition across rights across Europe. And since 1996, the European Court of Human Rights has made clear that there's a requirement for states to put in place processes for gender recognition. And we know that since 2015, the Parliamentary Assembly of the Council of Europe, in its resolution 2048, called on all states to develop quick, transparent, and accessible procedures based on self-determination. So we welcome the work to bring Scotland into line with this recommendation and note the work that's happening in other countries on this issue, alongside the necessary work to support services and make sure support's available for all children and young people under 18. Thank you.
Thank you, Bruce. And Ellie.
Thanks very much. The National Union of Students has a long and proud history of standing up for LGBT plus rights, and I'm pleased to be speaking to the committee today. In my first official capacity as NUS Scotland's president-elect, and as the first openly trans person to assume the role of NUS Scotland president. And as such, I bring to the committee today both my own personal experiences of being a trans woman in Scotland and the experiences and views of Scotland's student movement as we strongly support the reform of the Gender Recognition Act. This bill is one of the most widely consulted on pieces of legislation in the history of the Scottish Parliament, and we welcome that the bill is being taken forward to bring Scotland closer to international best practice. In particular, we welcome the proposed removal of the requirement for a diagnosis of gender dysphoria in order to obtain a gender recognition certificate. The World Health Organization no longer recognizes gender dysphoria as a mental health condition as of the ICD-11, but the current process to obtain a gender recognition certificate in Scotland effectively still treats it as such. This does not match the experiences of most trans people and only increases stigma. This is just one part of the highly medicalised gender recognition certificate process, which is intrusive, invasive and dehumanising. The current requirement for a diagnosis of gender dysphoria, as well as invasive medical questions, is only made even harder for trans people due to the horrific waiting times for Scotland's NHS gender identity clinics. Current wait times for just an initial appointment can be over 4 years, and the cost of private healthcare and doctor's letters is simply unaffordable for many trans people who are disproportionately likely to be experiencing poverty. This is particularly inaccessible for those of us who are also students. Our student loans often don't even cover the cost of the roof above our heads, let alone private healthcare. We also support provisions in the bill to reduce the minimum age for applicants from 18 to 16. We know from research conducted by NUS in 2014 that young trans students can face specific challenges due to their legal documents not matching their lived reality. In particular, this can cause real distress if a trans student is forced to register with their institution in the wrong gender, or where there are incongruences between different legal documents. This can cause confusion and even unnecessary investigations into fraud when applying for things like student finance. So this is a hugely important piece of legislation for trans people in Scotland, and it's incredibly important that we get it right. So I thank the committee for hearing our views, and I look forward to answering any questions you may have. Thank you.
Thanks very much, Ellie. So we'll now move on to questions, starting with Maggie Chapman.
Thanks very much, Joe. Good morning to both Bruce and Ellie. Thanks for being with us this morning. Bruce, if I could come to you first. In your opening remarks, you highlighted the three areas of concern or areas where you wish there to be greater clarity. Can I just ask for a little bit more detail around your concerns or questions around the role of the Registrar General, and how you would see those being dealt with effectively? Thanks.
Yeah, thank you. In our view, there's still not yet sufficient clarity in terms of issues around children's rights to privacy and data protection, in terms of what investigative or scrutiny role that the Registrar General might have in assessing a child's understanding or capacity. Because that would generally be only appropriate for a suitably qualified professional or medical professional in other areas of children's lives. And so we're really interested in what additional resourcing and support will be put in place for the Registrar General in order to ensure that the information that's being assessed is appropriate. Also, what information is being sought and what evidence will be sought by the Registrar. In the Council of Europe's Child Friendly Justice Guidelines, they outline the need for child to be able to access justice and have a fair hearing, but also to be able to obtain independent advice and advocacy in all administrative processes and challenges around that. And so I think there's still some more information that's needed about how this process will work in terms of what questions will be asked and by who and how, and also what support will be provided. We're very keen to make sure that there's more identification of what support will be available for young people going through this process. The move to move away from a tribunal to an administrative process is a legitimate aim in terms of removing barriers and unnecessary hurdles in the process of obtaining a gender recognition certificate. And this is very much in line with the recognition to ensure the growing autonomy of children. But it also needs to come for those young people with protective and supportive processes based on their ability to engage with it. And so a few key points would be reflecting again on that obligation to non-discrimination and the active obligation to take positive action to support young people who might require special measures or protections. And also in terms of safeguards, so there are safeguards provided in other aspects of Scots law where children are exercising participation rights. And so if we look to Section 3 of the Age of Legal Capacity Act 1991, which sets out issues around capacity, there are strong protections to make sure that there's no detriment or adverse consequences for children. And the protections need to be put in place to make sure that that's there as well. In the policy memo, the Scottish Government said that there will be further need for clear and accessible guidance and support for younger applicants to ensure that they understand and carefully consider their decision, and that's absolutely essential. So what would be useful throughout the process would be to ensure that we understand what that guidance will be and what supports will be available, particularly for 16 and 17-year-olds, to make sure that they fully understand the implications of legal gender recognition, but also that they have the support that they're entitled to. In the Bill's financial memorandum, the anticipated costs are primarily associated with the cost of IT systems and application forms, but also we would like to see proper support put in to make sure that the processes for additional careful consideration of applications for 16 and 17-year-olds, or the possibility of sense of investigation, which could include face-to-face conversations with the applicants, we'd need to be very clear about how this is being supported and who would be doing that, where those skills are going to be coming from. And children and young people need to be involved in developing those systems as well. I think there's more need to make sure that young people are actually involved in developing the systems that will help them go through this process. And that's reflected very strongly in Article 12, particularly Article 12.2 of the Convention on the Rights of the Child, which actually gives additional participation rights in the context of judicial and administrative proceedings. And so this would be covered in terms of the additional obligation on the state to make sure that there's special consideration for 16 and 17-year-olds going through this administrative process, and making sure that the Register General is adequately resourced and supported to ensure that they can fully respect, protect and fulfil children's rights in the context of the 16 and 17-year-olds who will be included here, making sure that they can understand the respect for child's private life and that it's a child-friendly administrative process. And so all of this for me really comes back primarily to ensuring support and linking back to the fact that this is seen and recognised as inherent to someone's personal dignity, and that respecting and maintaining that is vitally important, particularly for those under 18. And it would be very useful to have more information about what support will be provided to young people accessing this process.
Thanks, Bruce. That's helpful. And in your opening remarks, you also very, very clearly highlighted that the positive duty that we have that to ensure the accessing of rights by young people. Can I just ask whether you have any examples or whether they've been... You talk about the administrative process and the need for that to be child-friendly, for that to be a clear process as well. Are there any examples elsewhere where an administrative process is not adequate, or you know, where the administrative process for gender recognition has fallen short in some way that you're aware of?
In terms of our discussions with other countries, no, we don't have a lot of information on that. We have been discussing with children's commissioners and ombuds in some of the countries that do have systems in place for gender recognition for those under the age of 18. But I couldn't at this stage point to a specific example. I think more generally, though, it's probably useful to say that generally most systems that are administrative or judicial are designed by adults for adults, and usually they're not particularly child-friendly at all. And so there's been a strong push across both judicial and administrative systems, including things like complaint systems, to actually take a much more child-friendly approach. And I think that this is another part of much broader work that needs to be done to involve children and young people in the design of processes that they're going to be using, because most administrative processes can be very challenging, even for adults. And so we have to take into account the additional obligation, and the best way to do that is to involve young people in the design of the process.
Okay, thanks. That's helpful. And I suppose, as you say, if it's a good process for young people, it'll be a better process for everybody anyway. Ellie, could I come to you and ask, do you echo the calls for further information around the role of the Registrar General and the resources and support that will be available? Do you have any comments on that?
Absolutely. I'd align myself with what Bruce was saying there. I think that actually, you know, not just for young people, but for anyone, you know, having that support to be able to complete the process is always welcome. I often often joke, but there's a lot of truth in it that actually the hardest part about being trans is the admin, and I think that a process like applying for a gender recognition certificate can be really tricky. Having that support in place, as has been said, if you have that support in place for young people, it makes it more accessible for everyone.
Thanks. I'll leave it there for now.
Okay, thank you. And Pam Gossel, please.
Thank you, Convener. Good morning, panel, and thank you for your opening statements. Going back to the mechanisms and the process, just asking the Commissioner, your response to the consultation highlighted that there is no mechanism in the proposed reforms for setting out an individual child's understanding of the process and its consequences would be assessed. Does that concern still stand?
I think there needs to be much more support and explanation of what those supports will be available and how any assessment would be made, recognising the additional protection rights that we have to those that are under 18. And so what supports will be available to ensure that understanding, and what assessment might be made in terms of assessing that a young person doesn't understand, and what mechanisms would a young person have for challenging that. So there is still some further clarity that's needed about the process, yes.
Thank you. Just a follow-up on that, Commissioner. Obviously, the consideration of cost doesn't explicitly factor in the development of additional careful consideration of applications from children, or the sensitive investigation, or even the face-to-face applications. And you also stated it's unclear whether national records of Scotland currently have the expertise to undertake such a role and are likely to require additional specialised staffing. So do you believe that the provisions of the support has been hastily thought about and no real consideration of its potential costs or services will be provided?
I'd certainly like more explanation in terms of additional funding that might be required and what that would actually look like. And again, I would like to see young people involved in those discussions. So them saying this is what we think that we would need. This is what would help us with the process. So I think that there's more information that needs to be drawn out through the legislative process, particularly around what support would be available to put in place for those things, because it's not contained currently within the financial memorandum. And so I think that there's more information that's needed.
And just a question to Ellie and yourself. Last week, we heard from the EHRC that individuals who acquire a GRC can access women's and girls' single-sex spaces, such as toilets, changing rooms, refuges, hospital wards, and that the inclusion of individuals with GRC would be direct discrimination subject to justification. There are concerns from those opposed to the bill and that the self-declaration aspect could open the bill up to abuse by bad faith actors. Do you think that there are certain groups of individuals, for example, those in the sex offenders register, that should be ineligible to apply for the GRC on the basis of self-declaration? And if not, are there any other safeguards you think would be best placed to ensure that there are no unintended consequences of the bill on children's rights? And I'll go to Ellie first on that one.
Thanks very much for the question. I think that it's really, really important that we're absolutely clear on what this bill does. Single-sex spaces are covered under the Equality Act, and having a gender recognition certificate has no impact on anyone's access to things like toilets, changing rooms. Many trans people who have not obtained a gender recognition certificate will still access single-sex spaces that align with their gender rather than their gender assigned at birth. And I think it's really important that we're clear that this bill won't have any impact on access to single-sex spaces. And as such, I don't think that there's any category of person who would be excluded from applying to the bill. I think it's also really important that we're we also think about how if a predator was wanting to access single-sex spaces, in order to commit crimes, they would not go through the process of making a statutory declaration of obtaining an already quite difficult to obtain gender recognition certificate in order to do so. People don't check birth certificates as you walk into a toilet. To commit those crimes, they are crimes. They're already against the law. And so there wouldn't be any difference whether someone had a gender recognition certificate or not.
Sorry, Ellie, just to follow up on that, you just mentioned there the fact that, the process is pretty rigorous right now, but then the process going forward with this bill would be much easier. So do you think that there's no safeguards in place that would open up to these predators?
I mean, I think the safeguard is that even if we simplify the process, it's still a process of making a statutory declaration. I don't see any reason why anyone would do that unless they were genuinely trans. I think it's also important that we acknowledge the stigma and hostility that still comes about in society today, unfortunately, with being trans. And I don't think that anyone would put themselves through that in order to commit a crime that they would be able to commit regardless of whether they had that certificate or not. It has no bearing on it. I think that it's, we have to be really, really clear on what having a gender recognition certificate does, and accessing single-sex spaces is simply something that it doesn't do.
Thank you, Ellie. Commissioner, over to you. Obviously, this is a big concern out there, obviously, and a big question everybody's asking. So if you can give me your view on this.
Yeah, thanks. I agree with Ellie. I think that addressing those risks that you've identified and people are concerned about are better done through the individual assessment as currently done. I think there's certainly a lot of discussion we should be having about strengthening protections against those individuals who are at risk. But rather than implying a whole category of people are at risk and restricting their rights, we need to look at how to strengthen the protections against those individuals who are at risk. We certainly shouldn't be dismissing these concerns more generally. We need to be discussing them very openly, and we have to be very careful to make sure that in ensuring the objectives of this bill, that there aren't unintended consequences. But we also, as Ellie said, do need to be careful in framing these concerns, that it doesn't lead us back to the very thing we're trying to address, which is further stigmatising a group already significantly at risk in terms of their rights. And the experts have looked at this in detail. I felt that the concerns haven't been evidenced kind of internationally, that people would be using this in that way, partly for the reasons that Ellie has said. So I agree with the government's position, and particularly would point you to the analysis set out by the Scottish Human Rights Commission, that the process of acquiring a gender recognition certificate, which is the purpose of this bill, doesn't increase those risks or negatively affect those rights. If there was real and concrete risk of the rights of others, sorry, there's some noise. If there are real or concrete risks to the rights of others emerging from the progress towards the fulfilment of human rights of trans people, human rights law actually provides for a balancing mechanism with which to resolve that. Because the manner and exercise and fulfilment of one person's rights, if that does create a real and concrete prospect of harm to others, there can be a balance to ensure a fair outcome. But it is down to whether there's a real and concrete prospect of harm that would justify the interference with the Article rights, the Article 8 rights, the right to respect for private and family life of transgender people. And so we'd need to come back to whether there was a prospect of substantial detriments in order to have a look to see whether there's a fair balance of that. So I agree with the Scottish Human Rights Commission that that the removal, that, that there won't be any kind of change in relation to single-sex services, etc., and that the Equality Act will continue to apply because already we have the GRC not being determinative, and where there's an objective justification and a proportionate means of achieving that aim. And EHRCPC last week, I think, recognised that and saying decisions about single-sex services, excluding or providing a different service to trans people needs to be justified whether, regardless of whether an individual has. So I think addressing the risks posed by individuals needs to be done by strengthening the protections against the risk that those individuals pose, rather than the implication that a whole category of people are a risk and further risk stigmatising trans people. We've spoken to colleagues in Malta and Norway and Ireland who have each, within the last 10 years, legislated to provide legal gender recognition for under 18s. And our colleagues reported that they haven't identified any of the negative impacts which people are concerned about. But certainly, as we change and do better at recognising that the rights of trans people, and particularly trans young people, of course, there's more need to research over time and very close monitoring to ensure that there aren't any unintended consequences or impacts. And so it is something that we need to closely monitor, but there isn't evidence at this stage to suggest that we could create additional barriers on the basis of risk, which isn't evidence.
OK, thanks, Bruce. Thanks, Pam. And if we go up, Pam Duncan-Glancy, please.
Thank you, convener, and thank you to the panel for your answers so far and your submissions in advance. They've been really helpful. I want to ask a question about the time periods, if that's okay. And specifically, could first of all, Ellie, could you set out the impact that the time period could have on young people and in particular students? And that's both the 3-month wait in advance and the 3-month reflection period. And can you also talk a little bit about the current longer time period and the impact that can have? And then, Bruce, if it's OK, if you could also talk about those two time periods as well. Thanks.
Yeah, thanks very much. I think that we don't support having these sort of arbitrary time periods that are currently included in the bill. There's no evidence of their benefit. And I think that it's really important for us to acknowledge that, as I said in my previous answer, that coming out as trans is quite a big step for people to do. And trans people will likely have undergone quite a considerable amount of reflection and thought before they come out. And I think that the current 2-year waiting period, we have to sort of prove that you've been living in your acquired gender, as I think it's described. That's something that's quite difficult to prove. I would challenge cisgender people to maybe think about how they would prove that they'd been living as their gender for any period of time, without sort of narrowing that gender down to arbitrary stereotypes. And as a result, the main way in which you would prove that, whether it's a 3-month waiting period or a 2-month waiting period, is through usually forms of ID. So things like having a driving license or a passport that has your true name and titles on it. That can be really, really expensive. The cost of getting a driving license can be a significant cost, especially for young people who aren't likely to have spare money in their pocket, and a passport even more expensive, and as a result that can be a huge barrier. The other thing as well is, of course, that having that waiting period that means that, that during that period where you might have some documents changed or others not, or you are living as your true gender without having the you know, the documents to sort of back that up, can cause some real difficulties you know, in basic administrative tasks. So things like applying to you know, college or university, it might mean that, that during that period you have to register as you know, your gender assigned at birth, which doesn't necessarily match the gender that, that you're living and presenting as. And that can be really dehumanising and stigmatising. In addition, as I mentioned in my opening remarks, where you might have some documents such as a passport or driving licence that have been updated and others such as a birth certificate that haven't, if you're submitting both of those to an application for something like, you know, student finance, then that can even lead to potential, you know, unnecessary investigations into fraud. So it can cause some real challenges there. I think what's really key is that whether we're talking about, you know, a 3-month waiting period or reflection period, that, that there's no evidence that shows that this would be a benefit to applicants for a gender recognition certificate. And, you know, as I say, you know, anyone who would be applying for you know, what's quite a serious thing would have undergone a significant period of reflection by themselves anyway. Applying for a gender recognition certificate is often one of the last things actually that a trans person will do, because it tends to have less of an impact you know, than things like you know, how you present or you know, how you're known to people.
Thank you. Bruce, are you okay to pick that up as well, please? Thanks.
I am, and I think the committee's already heard directly from trans people, including trans young people, around the challenges here. So I think that's absolutely key, that that you're hearing their voices directly in terms of the impacts and challenges around this. The bill doesn't provide any guidance to define what's living in an acquired gender means, and so there are some questions here around if there's a process which applies to children, how would staff dealing with those applications make an assessment of a child's understanding of it? And again, so that's a similar concern we have in relation to person with an interest as well. I think that there's also risk here around the danger of reinforcing the socially constructed gender roles. And I think that a particular relevance here would be the work done jointly between the Committee on the Rights of the Child and the Committee on the Elimination of Discrimination Against Women, who issued a joint general comments, general recommendation, which touched upon some of the damaging things to women and children's rights of gender stereotyping and more broadly. And so there's a question in terms of whether this increases the risk of some of those concerns. Time periods, I think, will always appear arbitrary unless they're linked to the supportive provision for everybody, but obviously my concern is young people. So I think in assessing whether this kind of additional barrier, this additional time is necessary and proportionate, I would like to have more explanation in terms of whether it's perhaps in some way associated with additional support or access to services. This is a conversation that we've been having with Irish colleagues. They've been working on this for some time now. And one of the things that they've been looking at in terms of if we are putting in place kind of timeframes or additional barriers making the system more complicated or longer, that should only happen if it brings with it the entitlement to access other services that are useful to trans young people. And so I'm unclear here in terms of whether there is any particular additional support that you might get during the prior period or particularly during the 3-month reflection period. But that doesn't seem to be very clear. But that would seem to me probably the main justification that you might use in terms of that it allowed you to access additional support services, and therefore that speaks to the kind of proportionality or purpose of it.
Okay, thank you very much. Can I go to Karen, please?
Thank you, Convener, and good morning to you both. It's lovely to see you here. We've touched upon a little bit about the reducing of the minimum age to obtain a gender recognition certificate from 18 to 16. And there has been some quite polarised views on this in regards to the competency of the young person and whether there should be parental consent involved with this. So I would just be interested in hearing both your views on that. If I could start with Bruce, please.
Thanks. Yeah, very, very pleased to start. We support the move to lowering the age to 16. Protection and participation rights aren't mutually exclusive. So a process which recognises the growing autonomy of young people, but also recognising the need to support and protect them is what we're looking for. Minimum ages can be very confusing and complicated, but the Convention on the Rights of the Child says very clearly that when you're putting in place something for protection, for example, in relation to the justice system and the age of criminal responsibility, what you're looking to do is put in place a very high age of things like criminal responsibility, or where the minimum age is necessary to correct potential abuses in relation to things like sexual consent, then you need to make sure that the children's rights aren't damaged through that process. But where age restrictions don't serve a protective purpose and potentially curb children's rights to development and their freedoms, then minimum ages should be avoided. And so in situations where you've got that tension between protection and autonomy, which comes up a lot in relation to things like consent and medical treatment, you should be looking to the capacity as the deciding factor. Scots law is... it would probably be kindest to say that it's developed in an ad hoc manner. And so we've got a very confusing range of age thresholds for children. It's one of the things that children and young people often express kind of concern and confusion around, because it does create a really confusing and inconsistent landscape in terms of age thresholds, which often appear to be arbitrary to children themselves. For example, in Scotland, we've got an age of criminal responsibility at 12, 2 years below the international minimum, and we imprison older children, but they can't vote until they're 16 for Parliament, Scottish Parliament, local government elections, or 18. For UK elections and referenda. So the convention requires that all children, including the 16 and 17 year olds bought, catered for in this bill, and says that they need to be treated as children in all circumstances. And so that's the protective element, the things I was talking about before in terms of making sure that they have the support that they're needed, but strongly recognises the growing and evolving capacities as children transition into adulthood. And so it doesn't mean that you lose your right to protection and support, so those things have to be in place, but actually the levels of responsibility that you get need to be recognised as well. Protection and participation aren't mutually exclusive, and so the recognition of the autonomy of the young people included in this bill I think is very welcome, but that does not obligate the need to provide support and protection. And there's nothing actually in the bill in terms of how an individual child's understanding of the process and consequences will be assessed. This goes back to the point that I was making earlier. And so there needs to be more discussion around what support would be in place there. And we can look to other parts of Scots law in relation to that. The Scottish Government said that there's need for further guidance to ensure the understanding and consideration of the decision, and that National Records of Scotland already routinely gives careful consideration to other issues. But in relation to this, they'll need to make sure that there's a supportive process and clarity in terms of if and when necessary it'll be to undertake these sensitive investigations which are set out, which apparently could include face-to-face conversations. So the intention to ensure that every 16 or 17 year old would be offered or encouraged to take up the option of a conversation to talk through the process is welcome, but more information is needed at this stage. That's quite there's quite limited information in terms of what that would look like and how it would play out. And again, it goes back, without repeating myself, to the issue of making sure that funding and specialist support is in place. You'd asked in relation to parental consent. In some other countries, there is a requirement for parental consent for under 18. None of those are directly analogous with the Scottish proposals. And also, I would say that reflects something that goes throughout kind of children's rights. In many of those countries, parental consent is needed for a lot more, particularly in relation to accessing health services and others. This is work that we have done a lot on kind of previously, and Scotland takes a very different approach in terms of recognising the autonomy of children and young people. And in some other countries, there's a much more paternalistic approach, which doesn't properly recognise the rights in the Convention on the Rights of the Child, where parental involvement can often be throughout childhood. And so it certainly wouldn't be an approach that we would want to go down in terms of moving towards that more paternalistic approach. We strongly recognise the important role and the primary responsibility on parents to provide guidance support to their children, and on the state to ensure that parents are supported in that role. But we wouldn't want to see that come in and infringe on the growing autonomy of children and young people, and that wouldn't be consistent with the way that Scotland usually approaches them.
Thanks, Bruce. And going forward, I wonder if Bruce in particular, because I can't send the signal to you, we need to have slightly sharper questions, because we've got quite a lot of questions still to come through. Back to Karen.
Thank you. Thank you, Bruce, for that answer. And in particular, I'm really interested in how we can see this support and guidance for young people going forward and try and take note of that. Could I ask Ellie the same question, please?
Absolutely. We support the provisions in the bill to lower the age to 16. A lot of the students that we represent in further education will be 16 or 17. Many students starting university will be 17. And of course, those students who will be applying to further or higher education at those ages will likely be 16, 17 or even younger. And so it's really, really important that those students are able to obtain a gender recognition certificate without parental consent, for some of those reasons that I outlined earlier around some of those difficulties that can arise where you might have to register for your institution in the wrong gender and some of the complications that can cause. So for example, on top of what I mentioned earlier, there can be some challenges where if you are graduating under a different name or gender than where you've registered the institution with, that can cause some complications, and it can make it really difficult actually for you to be able to obtain your qualification in such a way that it doesn't out you anytime that you present it. Equally, actually, just the distress that can arise from attending college or university and being recorded incorrectly. There was a study, the Trans Edu Scotland study by Dr. Stephanie McKendry and Dr. Madison Lawrence in 2017, found that 86% of respondents across further and higher education in Scotland experienced barriers to their learning or work as a result of their trans or gender identity. And equally, we know from young trans people who undertook LGBT Youth Scotland's Life in Scotland for LGBT Young People, that research showed the considerable mental health issues that young trans people in Scotland face, with suicidal thoughts at 66% of trans participants, which is almost double that of cisgender participants at 34%. So we see some of the distress that's caused to trans young people in Scotland, and by allowing them to obtain a gender recognition certificate and be recognised as their true identity, that will remove a lot of those barriers and remove a lot of the distress that they currently face.
Great, thank you.
Okay, thank you. And Pam Duncan-Glancy.
Thank you, Convener. I just had a follow-up for one of Bruce's responses, if that's okay, Bruce. You've spoken about the need to obviously balance the right to participation and protection and the autonomy. Could you tell us a bit more about how we could make sure the bill did that in terms of specific potentially areas where it could be amended around the statute declaration so that we can balance participation and protection appropriately? And could you also maybe talk a little bit about the presumption in the Children's Bill that children at the age of 16 have got capacity in the courts, and that's a kind of early assumption. Is that something that should be applied here, or how could we address the differences in this legislation across the others?
Thanks, Pam, and also noting the convener's instruction with relation to brevity. I think that part of this really is around some of the things in kind of guidance and support and training in terms of understanding what's going to be happening, rather than necessarily a need for amendment to the bill itself. It's answering some of those unanswered questions in terms of what that would look like, and also really addressing the issue that young people don't seem to have been involved in the development and consideration of these processes. And so I don't have specific recommendations in terms of amendments to the bill. What I would like to see would be more explanation from government in terms of what the intention is here, in terms of ensuring that support is going to be put in place and how young people will be involved in it.
Thank you.
Okay, thank you. And Alexander.
Thank you, convener, and good morning, members of the panel. In the bill, we talk about residency and does provide in the bill that those born in Scotland or those ordinarily resident in Scotland may have the opportunity to apply for a gender recognition certificate. And there have been some concerns expressed that might mean that trans people from other parts of the United Kingdom may then choose to come to Scotland to apply for that gender recognition certificate. And that may be because they have and not the supportive network that they have at home or their family circumstances. So can I maybe ask Bruce initially and then come to Ellie, do you believe that is a potential and is a concern? And can you explain the views that you may have on the requirement for this residency in relation to 16 and 17-year-olds? So Bruce first.
It's not an issue that we're... Sorry, it's not an issue that we've looked into in detail. I think that any country that puts in place a progressive human rights approach, I would hope does have people wanting to come and move to that country. And in terms of being ordinarily resident, obviously we'd need to look into ensuring that was properly interpreted. But it's not something that's come up in the context of the discussions we've had with those in other countries in terms of kind of the kind of tourism, in terms of someone coming for the specific purpose of that. It's not something that's been raised with us by colleagues internationally.
Any views on that?
This isn't something that like Bruce, I've looked particularly into, but I would just add that I myself actually I was born and raised in England when I was deciding to come to university and looking at, you know, different institutions that I might like to go to. I was really keen actually to move to a Scottish university because of some of the more progressive general sort of politics and approach to equality that you know, in my view, Scotland was taking, and I would hope that we would attract people from not just the rest of the UK but from anywhere who wants to live in Scotland because of that progressive approach. I would say that there have been another example where there was, sort of the fear that people might come to Scotland to take advantage is actually when you look at things like free tuition, which is something that I'm a fee paying student in Scotland because I'm English and I pay the £9,250 a year for my studies. And certainly our position at NUS is that actually, if we take a more progressive approach and that attracts people to move to Scotland, then that's something that should be welcomed. And I think that is mirrored both in our attitude towards tuition fees and gender recognition certificates.
And Bruce earlier on, you talked about the support mechanisms required to indicate that the 16 or 17-year-old would have a friendly, a dignified and a respectful approach to how they are managed and how they are progressed. So under this whole area, do you believe that we do have that the present, and does the bill give that flavour to ensure that someone who is either 16 or 17 would be being fulfilled in this process at this stage?
I think that's a great question to ask 16 and 17-year-olds. I think that there's more information needed in terms of what that will actually look like and the process for which it would be developed. And so I'm not necessarily saying that that needs to change on the face of the bill, but throughout the passage of the bill, I would like to see more information on that.
And Ellie, you as well, that you believe in that as well, that there needs to be a better and a more respectful, and that whole process is managing to challenge and can contain that.
Yes, absolutely.
Okay. Thank you, Convener.
Okay, thank you. And Fulton.
Thanks very much, Convener, and good morning to the panel. I've got two broad areas of questioning, Convener, if you don't mind. And the first is on the diagnosis of gender dysphoria or a support that the committee's heard for the removal of this requirement. Now, Ellie, we've heard from yourself already in your opening statement. I think you've made your views and the views of your organisation quite clear in this, but I wonder if before I come to Bruce if there was anything else on this particular requirement that you wanted to put on the record for committee members.
I think that I did cover most of it in my opening statement. I think that what we're seeing around the world in international best practice is that, you know, there is no requirement for a diagnosis of gender dysphoria. That doesn't match the experiences of a lot of trans people. And I think that it's really important that you know, we acknowledge that actually, you know, that doesn't necessarily fit into our experiences. But equally, that, you know, requiring that diagnosis, it's actually the reason why I've not sought a gender recognition certificate myself yet, because I've been sitting on the waiting list for the Sandyford Clinic, gender identity clinic in Glasgow for just under 4 years now. I have no sight of when my initial appointment will be. That's just an initial appointment. That's you know, doesn't necessarily mean that anything will happen at that appointment. And I don't have the money to be able to afford, you know, to go down that sort of, you know, private healthcare route of you know, getting doctor's letters and things like that, and paying a significant cost. So that can be a real barrier to trans people. In answering Pam Duncan Glantz's question earlier around the waiting periods, I spoke a little bit about how those waiting periods cause significant distress and harm to trans people, and having that requirement of gender dysphoria is essentially another huge waiting period, often, as I say, of over 4 years, because of that requirement to you know, go down that sort of medical route. I think the other thing, of course, as well, is that you know, the medicalization of the process is again quite arbitrary. You know, not all trans people will have a desire to you know, medically transition. And so that requirement to go down any sort of medicalised process, again, it doesn't fit in with our experiences, and it can be a little bit, you know, it again can you know, cause stigma, and can be a little bit dehumanising actually to you know, require us to you know, be diagnosed with, you know, a mental health condition, for instance, in order to obtain that certificate.
Okay, thanks very much for that, and taking the opportunity to reinforce your point from earlier. Bruce, have you got any thoughts on this particular area?
I think other witnesses have covered this very well. Internationally, there's a clear move away from the pathologicalisation in terms of it being a mental disorder by the World Health Organizations and other international health bodies, allied with strong calls from the international human rights bodies on the need for reform as well. And again, the work of the UN Independent Expert on Protection Against Violence Based on Sexual Orientation and Gender Identity goes into this in detail, again, at the Council of Europe level, strong recommendations to governments to take this approach. And I think a growing consensus on this to the extent that the margin of appreciation allowed, the discretion allowed to take the kind of medicalized approach is certainly narrowing. So that's very much the direction of travel. And so very supportive of Scotland's following that international trend and call from international human rights bodies.
Thanks for that, Bruce. The second area that I've got, Convener, is around about the provision for it to be a criminal offence to make a false statutory declaration or application. And Bruce, I'll come to you firstly this time, because you talked about in your open remarks about your worry about the impact that could have, particularly on 16 and 17-year-olds. We are obviously in your role you're coming from. I wonder if you can expand on that and let me know what your concerns are. And I noticed in a previous answer you did talk about the, in another context, albeit, the Age of Criminal Responsibility Bill, which I was a member of this committee that took that through as well. So, you know, given where I think the country are perhaps trying to go in terms of the criminalisation of children, where do you think this provision fits in with that?
Now you're really challenging me on keeping to the instruction to be brief, because as you're very well aware, and members of the former committee looking at this, and I hope members of the current committee are very well aware of my position on the criminalisation of children, and the fact that we criminalise children at 12, 2 years below the international minimum set by the UN and the Council of Europe, is a breach of our obligations, and it has serious impacts on individuals and sends a worrying message. And the fact that we imprison children, often with tragic consequences, these really stand out as significant breaches of our commitment to children and young people. And so there is a risk here, by including the criminal penalty for making a false statutory declaration, that children will be unnecessarily criminalised. And the children's rights and wellbeing impact assessment doesn't evidence any assessment at all of the potential negative impact on this. There doesn't seem to be any consideration of the fact that children are entitled to extra protection, set out in Article 40 of the Convention on the Rights of the Child, which the committee's recently issued a comprehensive guidance on through a general comment. So it would really be for the government to show why it was necessary to criminalise children in these circumstances and set out, and they haven't done that. I do understand that others have pointed to this as a safeguard and underlying the importance of the decision as seen as a protective measure against abuse. But if that's to apply to children, then I would like to see an explanation in terms of what alternate measures that the government's explored to achieve the aim of safeguarding against abuse, and in terms of looking at what other approaches to fulfil that legitimate aim is. But this, as you've said, this is a much wider discussion around the age of criminal responsibility and imprisonment of children, and I really would ask the committee to address this as a matter of urgency, but I do recognise that the context of this evidence session probably isn't the place for that wider discussion.
Thanks, Bruce, and thanks for being as brief as you can there in an area that I know personally you're very, very passionate about. Ellie, if I could come to yourself on this question as well, I suppose if you could answer it in two parts, if you're able. In terms of the criminal offence, if you could look at it in terms of the 16 to 18-year-olds that you might represent, as Bruce has done, have you got any concerns there? And then, you know, in terms of the wider implications over 18s, if you like, that I know that your organisation will also represent.
So we would oppose the creation of a new criminal offence on this, that would actually be for pretty much the same reasons for 16 to 18 and over 18s. But I think that the implications are potentially stronger for 16 and 17-year-olds. At the moment, it's already an offence to make a false statutory declaration under the Criminal Law Consolidation Scotland Act 1995. So adding a new criminal offence to that, what that would do is it would probably act as a bit of a deterrent actually to trans people who would want to apply for a gender recognition certificate, and potentially put people off applying who otherwise would, because actually it can be quite a scary time already coming out as trans. Like I said earlier, mental health conditions and anxiety and things like that can come up, and having that additional offence could really worry people. I think the other thing as well that we should acknowledge is that I think it's fair to say that one of the main criticisms actually of the bill as it currently stands is the lack of recognition for non-binary people. That's something that we would certainly hope to see improved over the coming years. As it stands, and as the bill currently stands, non-binary people wouldn't be able to be recognised as non-binary by going through the gender recognition certificate process. However, some non-binary people might want to still go through that gender recognition certificate process because they feel that their gender aligns more closely to one of the two binary genders. And so there'd be a real concern that having that offence of making a false declaration would inadvertently criminalise some non-binary people who would potentially be, you know, getting a gender recognition certificate to align them more closely with one of the binary genders that doesn't necessarily match their identity, but more closely aligns with it. And then finally, the other part to this is that, you know, I think that we have to acknowledge some of the hostility around this current sort of debate around trans people and around this bill, and the fact that trans people still face a really quite horrific amount of transphobia in society, and there may be malicious individuals or groups who would want who would potentially misuse that clause to make false accusations or allegations to cause harassment, and so again I would really strongly oppose that bill. And I think like I say, that's for anyone regardless of age. A lot of those impacts that I've just described there will potentially be felt even more strongly for 16 and 17 year olds, particularly around that sort of fear and that deterrent around going through the process there.
Thanks. Just a quick follow-up to that. I appreciate that response, but and I think you did touch on it yourself. There is, while there's a great deal of support for the bill, and there's also a great deal of worry about the bill as well, which the committee are obviously hearing about. And I wanted to put it to you, Will, the committee are really keen as a whole that I think that we've bring in legislation that makes it as easy as possible for people to live the lives that they can, that they want. In terms of this bit about the criminal offence, do you not feel that it provides some reassurance to those that are perhaps opposed to the bill about some of the concerns that have been raised? And I think we've heard from you earlier and other panellists who have told us that it's very unlikely that the MD who applies for a certificate is going to have already been living as trans for quite some time, perhaps. It's already a decision that they took a long time ago. So do you not feel that having a criminal offence, if somebody makes a false declaration, does provide some reassurance to those who have perhaps got concerns about the bill?
I mean, as I say, making a false declaration would already be a criminal offence under the Act that I mentioned earlier, and I would hope that in itself would reassure those individuals with concerns. I don't think that a further criminal offence would be necessary. It wouldn't actually make any real significant difference in terms of the in terms of whether or not something's illegal or not. What it would create a difference in is that perception, and I think that fear and that deterrent for trans people would put some people off applying for it, and it would be an additional barrier, despite the fact that wouldn't make any difference in terms of the actual criminalisation of making a false declaration. So I'd hope that those people would be reassured by the fact that it's already criminalised. But I think if we add an additional law on top of that, then particularly those issues that I raised around non-binary people, for instance, would be much more likely to be targeted by such a law.
Thank you very much for that.
Thanks. Yep, thank you. Yep. And Maggie Chapman, please.
Thanks, Joe. Just coming back in, and it follows on, I think, from what you were saying a moment ago, Ellie. The bill also provides, there's a provision in the bill for a person with interest to seek to challenge a GRC, ask a sheriff to revoke a GRC. Can I ask what's NUA Scotland's position on that? What's the What's the take on that? Is it something you support? Is it something that gives you concerns? And then I'll come to Bruce.
Yeah, I think I have, and we have some concerns around that, because again, it could potentially be used, with malice intent. If again, there are a variety of reasons, what am I trying to say? There's a lot of interest in this bill. A trans person could come out and obtain a gender recognition certificate, and if someone who could be defined as a person with interests opposed that for any variety of reasons, then that could potentially create a really hostile and dangerous environment for that trans person. So I think it's really important that the approach that we're taking here is focused on the trans person themselves. I think it's also really important for us to acknowledge again what this bill actually does and what having a gender recognition certificate actually does. And the main things that it does do is it can make administrative tasks around making applications and things like that a little bit easier. It can change how you are recorded after you've passed away on your death certificate, and those are issues that will only affect the trans person themselves. In terms of the one other thing that it does, which is around marriage certificates and how people are recorded after getting married, then that's the only instance in which that might affect someone else. But in those instances, we would support that people should be able to divorce or separate for any reason, and that revoking someone's gender recognition certificate wouldn't be the solution there if someone was unhappy with the fact that their partner had changed their legal gender. It would be divorce. So I don't think that there's any reason why that would be something we'd support.
Thanks, Ellie. That's helpful. Bruce, can I come to you? You've talked about, or in submission, a potential concern around this provision for care experience to young people. Can you just say a little bit more about that?
Yeah, I'll be really focused here in terms of concerned that the Children's Rights and Wellbeing Impact Assessment accompanying the bill doesn't explicitly consider the situation of care experience children and young people who may be legally looked after. And so that legal status puts in place additional obligations on the state and corporate parenting throughout childhood and into early adulthood. And so there's some questions here in practical terms, in terms of who would then have this ability as a person with an interest, because there's potential that this could be local authority staff involved in the care of a care experienced young person. And so more details needed, I think, around that specific concern in relation to care experienced young people and the potential to perhaps have a much larger pool of those that would be captured within this definition of a person with an interest.
Thanks, that's helpful.
Okay, thank you. Pam, did you want to come in with one final question?
I do, please. Thank you. Thank you, convener. The questions I have, they're kind of related, and they're on the international experience that you've shared. Bruce, I know you've mentioned it briefly, some of the international experience you have. Could you set out what your understanding is of how self-declaration has worked in other countries? And how the impact it's had on the rights of children and young people, either positive or negative. And could you also talk briefly about the way you said earlier that that human rights gives a mechanism to balance the rights when there is an interplay between two groups of rights. Could you talk about the international experience on that and how that may have been resolved elsewhere? Thank you.
Shall I go first then?
Please.
Yep. And to do that briefly, okay. We've been in contact with a number of ombudspersons on this. This isn't an issue that everyone has worked on, but particularly we've had good discussions with colleagues in Norway and Ireland. And each of these jurisdictions is legislated to provide legal gender recognition for under 18s. And so looking at the kind of evidence and research that they've done on it, we're taking a very similar position to that of the Ombudsman in Ireland, which is in simple terms that 16 and 17-year-olds should be enabled to apply for gender recognition in the same way as those aged over 18, but a strong focus on making sure that suitable support services are available for those children under 18 and the broader issue around support for those younger children not included within the proposals. And it goes back to gender identity being at the core of a person's dignity and having to be able to engage with these matters in a really safe environment. So the Ombudsman for Children's Office in Ireland has undertaken extensive work on this issue. They've provided written evidence to a number of consultations, kind of dating back many years. And so the committee may actually wish to seek their view directly on this, because I would say that they probably have the best evidence of experience and kind of process and direction of travel. The Norwegian Ombudsperson's Office has also provided us a summary of their work in relation to gender recognition. They're very positive about the rights, the benefits for including those over 16 without parental consent. Again, that's a feature of some parts of the Norwegian system, which is based on the fact that the age of medical and sexual maturity in Norway is 16. So in Norway, for children under the age of 16, the Ombudsman's actually arguing that they should be included in the same possibility based on the legal framework, the rights-based framework I set out earlier. And I'm now looking at recognition for the 6 to 16 age group in terms of what parental consent would be involved in that. But I think more broadly, this does speak to the fact that this is an evolving area and there does need to be ongoing research. There does need to be close and ongoing monitoring. And at the heart of that needs to be the lived experience of young trans people, but also the experience of other children as well, and linked to the expert research which is going on. And again, we're seeing that in other parts of the UK as well. And I think that it's important that we do recognise that there are challenges here, there are evidence gaps here, and this is going to be something that we're going to need to make sure that we continue to gather evidence, that we continue to monitor, and that we are open and mature enough to be able to challenge ourselves in terms of where we go to next and how to further ensure that we're respecting, protecting and fulfilling rights. And again, at risk of upsetting you, convener, I do need to say that in Scotland, the bill that was passed by the Scottish Parliament last year to incorporate the Convention on the Rights of the Child, which is still not in force 7.5 months after the Supreme Court judgment. And I note that there is a ministerial statement this afternoon on it, and I think it's absolutely essential that at that statement we see some clarity and progress. So I'm very much looking forward to hearing that, because that cuts right to the heart of this. Is we need to put children's voices, experience and rights at the heart of decision making, and we need to recognise that in evolving areas of rights, there's always going to be more questions to ask.
Ellie, do you want to comment on?
I don't think there's anything for me to add on top of what Chris has already said.
Okay, thank you. I think that concludes our questions. Thanks very much to Ellie and to Bruce for your evidence, and we'll now suspend briefly to change witnesses. And we now reconvene, and I welcome to our meeting our second panel of witnesses, Hugh Torrance, Executive Director of Leap Sport Scotland, and Malcolm Dingwall-Smith, Strategic Partnership Manager from Sport Scotland. You're both very welcome. Can I invite our witnesses to make short opening statements, starting with Hugh Torrance, please?
Thank you very much, Committee, for inviting me here this morning. When the Gender Recognition Act 2004 was being drafted, there was specific and considered consultation on the topic of sport, with the proposal of a specific exemption for sports competition. This exemption would mean that sports bodies would be able to make decisions about the inclusion or exclusion of transgender people, regardless of their legal gender recognition. In other words, this would mean that if the sports governing body assessed it as appropriate for that sport, then transgender people could be restricted from participating in competitions within that sport. When the Act was introduced, it therefore included Section 19, which enabled that exemption. This allowed sports governing bodies to create and implement those policies, which then restricted access to transgender people in sport. When sports bodies enacted those restrictions, it didn't matter how someone identified or whether they had a gender recognition certificate or not. It was clearly the intention of lawmakers to recognise that such restrictions were necessary and to ensure a legal mechanism for that. Section 19 of the Gender Recognition Act was then repealed with the introduction of the Equality Act in 2010, and the process of drafting the Equality Act also specifically looked at sport and considered it necessary to ensure for a continuation of that specific exemption for sports competitions, irrespective of the provisions of the Equality Act with regards to the protected characteristic of gender reassignment. These provisions were then incorporated as Section 195 of the Equality Act as it became. By doing this, it very directly and clearly addressed concerns that the Equality Act could in any way override the ability of sports governing bodies to restrict transgender people. So again, this means that if a sports body enacts these restrictions, then it doesn't matter how someone identifies or indeed whether they have a gender recognition certificate or not. So it was clearly the intention of lawmakers to recognise that the continuation of these restrictions on transgender people was necessary and to ensure a continued legal mechanism for that. It's also the case that gender recognition certificates are not used in sports eligibility processes, regardless of whether Section 195 of the Equality Act is being used or not. So as it currently stands, the exclusions described still stand, enabled by Section 195 of the Equality Act 2010, which continues to apply. None of the current gender recognition reform proposals change anything in the Equality Act, which is not up for review. That trans people's participation in sport has received such specific and detailed attention throughout the whole process of the creation of the Gender Recognition Act in the first place and then the Equality Act in 2010 demonstrates how important this issue has been seen and how clear the intention of lawmakers in this area has been. It's therefore our conclusion that the proposals in this new bill will not change the situation of trans people's participation in sport and that the practice of sport will not be affected by any of the proposals in this new bill. Those campaigning against gender recognition reform continue to raise sport frequently, despite many reassurances from sports bodies and from LGBTIQ plus organisations that the proposals do not change the legal position in relation to sport. As to the bill more widely, Leap Sports is supportive of the current proposals on the basis of the significant improvements that we believe that they will make to the lives and experiences of trans people in Scotland. And I look forward to answering any of your questions.
Thanks, Hugh. I can now invite Malcolm.
Thank you for inviting Sport Scotland to give evidence today. As the National Agency for Sport, our vision is of an active Scotland where everyone benefits from sport. We have a clear commitment to inclusion underpinning everything we do. Legislative provision currently exists to allow sports bodies to place restrictions on trans people participating in sport in certain specified circumstances if that is necessary to uphold fair competition or the safety of competitors. Those provisions are set out in Section 195 of the Equality Act and will not be impacted by the Gender Recognition Reform Bill. Therefore, it is our view that this bill in its current form would not impact significantly on sport. Looking briefly beyond the provisions of the draft bill at transgender inclusion in domestic sport generally, we want sport to be a place where everyone can be themselves, where everyone can take part, and where everyone is treated with kindness, dignity and respect. We recognise that there are still too many barriers to transgender people participating in sport. We also recognise that sport at every level required more practical advice and support to be able to maximise opportunities for inclusion and accessibility. With that in mind, we came together with the other home country sports councils to develop new guidance for transgender inclusion in domestic sport. Following extensive consultation and review of the evidence base, our guidance concludes that retained physical differences mean that it will not always be possible to balance transgender inclusion, competitive fairness and participant safety. We also concluded that there can be no one-size-fits-all approach across all sports. We are now encouraging and supporting Scottish governing bodies to use the guidance to develop sport-specific policies. Our recommendations encourage our national governing bodies to think in innovative and creative ways to ensure that nobody is left out. We now want to see meaningful and respectful consultation in developing these sport-specific approaches, which we hope will facilitate increased transgender participation and help sport to become more inclusive and diverse.
Thank you very much. So we now move to questions, starting with Pam Gosnell, please.
Thank you, Convener. Thank you, panel, for your opening statements. Hugh, you've touched a little bit on this, but just to go into a little bit more depth, how do you see the self-ID policies currently work across sports from grassroots to competitive elite levels? And what evidence base is there for the impact of testosterone on the performance?
Could you repeat the second part again, Pam? Sorry.
It's what evidence base is there the impact on testosterone on the performance?
So I think it's really important to maybe start off by clarifying that there are already many sports who have regulation policies that are enabled by Section 195 of the Equality Act. So it's not the case at the moment that a trans person can self-identify into any sport at any given point. This means that taking part in sport for many trans people already involves interpreting and adhering to those eligibility guidelines. before being able to play, and is one of the reasons why Malcolm's referenced the poor participation rates in sport and physical activity for trans people. And because the Equality Act is not up for review and there are no moves for it to be, then this situation is highly unlikely to change. I think in relation to the kind of second part of your question, forgive me a second just to find my notes here. The vast majority of trans people and folks in our network have been taking part in sport for many years and have been doing so without the need for a gender recognition certificate and been doing so in a way that has been welcomed by the participants and team members that they have. We see that happening all around Scotland on a week-to-week, day-to-day basis. And we kind of see that the majority of people are very supportive of that situation happening. We do recognise the kind of wider concerns there that there are, but we do also recognise that there are many, many people who are very supportive when it comes to participation in grassroots sport.
Is there anything you want to add, Malcolm, to that?
Am I right in saying your question was around testosterone levels? Yeah, so as part of the consultation that was, or the work that was done across the four home country sports councils, we looked at the scientific evidence that's available. Scientific evidence in this area does continue to emerge and it is a moving picture, but at the current time, we believe the emerging evidence does not support the view that testosterone suppression for 12 months will achieve parity of strength, stamina and physique for transgender women compared with females. As a result, that's the rationale for our position and the guidance that you can't necessarily at all times balance safety, inclusion and competitive fairness.
Thank you.
Okay, thank you. And Maggie.
Thanks very much, Joe, and good morning both. Thank you for joining us this morning. Can you describe some of the issues faced by different sports which do try to balance trans inclusion with fairness and safety? What are the things that they have to wrangle with, and how is it that different sports come to the decisions that they do? Malcolm, if I could start with you and then come to you.
Yeah, I mean, effectively, there is a concern that that allowing transgender, particularly transgender women, to compete in female sport creates an unlevel playing field as a result of those retained physical differences. It had been, I think, hoped by a lot of people in sport that the use of testosterone suppression would provide a mechanism for levelling up that playing field and allowing people to compete on the same basis. Unfortunately, that isn't where the evidence appears to be at this time. It has, as a result, particularly at the higher level, that has been the policy that a lot of federations have used, is around testosterone levels and testosterone suppression. What we're working with sports now to do is to look at their policies, to look at the structures of their sport, and say use a decision making framework to ask questions like where is it gender affected, the nature of the sport, do they want to put the emphasis on inclusion? Where do they want to put the emphasis on competitive fairness? That might be different within a sport, so it's not necessarily the case that sports would adopt a one-size-approach, a one-policy approach across the whole sport. You might take a different policy at grassroots community club level to the national championships, for example. We're also encouraging sports to think about other forms of their sport that they might wish to introduce or that might already exist that can be put alongside those other forms, the more traditional forms of the sport, to provide opportunities for everyone to compete.
Thanks, Malcolm. And Hugh?
I mean, just to add to what Malcolm's said, I think that against that kind of backdrop of change at the moment, there's quite a number of sports bodies which are currently consulting with trans people around what inclusion and fairness might look like for our community moving forward. It is important to recognise, I think, that sports governing bodies have been working with these issues for many years, and many of them have found very successful ways to improve inclusion both at grassroots level and indeed throughout the kind of competitive sports pathway. So whilst there is discussion going on around the emerging scientific evidence, actually the practice of trans people continuing to access and play sport continues, and the consultation around that continues.
Okay, thanks.
Okay, thank you. And Pam Duncan-Glancy, please.
Thank you, convener, and thank you. Good morning to the panel. Thank you for the submissions you've sent in, and also the answers you've given so far. I'm keen to explore a bit more about what happens now in relation to a gender recognition certificate and trans people's access to sport. Could you tell us about the use of a gender recognition certificate in any determination as to whether or not somebody is able to participate in a given sport? And what happens now, and what do you think would happen in the future after the changes, if the changes were to go through after they were made? And maybe start with Hugh, if that's OK.
Yeah. So as it currently stands at the moment, gender recognition certificates are not used for any part of the process of either participating in sport, applying to take part in sport, or indeed evidencing anything in relation to your participation in sport. So at the moment, none of that happens, and moving forward, there is nothing about the proposals which would change that in any way.
Could I just before you come back in, if that's OK, Malcolm, what are the sorts of factors that are considered when a trans person is looking to participate in a particular sport?
Mm-hmm. What is considered by the sports governing body? Yeah. So usually, and the way that it stands at the moment, if you are participating, it starts off with a self-declaration around your gender, and that is how you would identify which category that person would enter. There is no point in the process thereafter that a gender recognition certificate would be requested in order to verify that in any way. Other criteria beyond gender recognition certificate would be whatever that particular sports body had outlined as their particular criteria. And that might, under some of the current regulations, as Malcolm's pointed out, include some kind of documentation around testosterone levels or physician, but not related to gender recognition certificates themselves.
Thank you.
I just echo that the gender recognition certificate isn't used in general by sports as part of their process. I'm not aware of any sport that is using it or would intend to use it under the new circumstances. Hugh's absolutely right. The self-declaration process would be a declaration that the person is in line with the sports policy. It's slightly different to a self-ID process in that sense, and just to provide clarity on that.
Would it be possible just to tell us your understanding of what that difference is?
So when I say a self-declaration process, the declaration would be that they are in line with the policy of the sport, as opposed to a self-ID process. If the sport policy was a self-ID process, then it would be actually the same thing. If it was, for example, that transgender people were not permitted to participate in the sport in the gender that aligned with their with their identity, then they would be making that statement within the policy.
Okay, thank you. Could I ask one further follow-up to that?
Is it in the same area?
Yeah.
Yeah.
It's about the Section 195 of the Equality Act, and I know you both mentioned it briefly. Could you just say whether or not you think the bill will impact on that section specifically, just for the record?
We cannot see anywhere which will impact Section 195 of the Equality Act.
Sport Scotland's understanding is that it does not impact on Section 195 of the Equality Act.
Thank you.
Okay, thank you. And Alexander, please.
Thank you, convener. Malcolm, in your opening statement, you talked about that it might not always be able to balance, and that you needed creative ways, and that this should be meaningful and respectful. So Sport Scotland, jointly with the UK Sporting Councils, issued guidance last year, and they found that there were two polarising issues with reference to that there was on one side that the trans people should be included in sport and that there should not be any restriction. The other saw that trans inclusion should be subject to regulation to ensure fair sporting competition. Now, the UK sporting councils themselves advised that there should be some kind of balance, but they also indicated that bodies should define their own rules of using a framework to interpret some of the guidance, and also that that would help to support outcomes for each sport. So can I ask specifically, when we're looking at Scotland being and bodies in Scotland being supported, what balance is there to ensure that trans inclusion in sport is given the fairness and the safety that is required?
Yeah, so I think to be clear, the two polarising viewpoints that were referred to were viewpoints that came out of the consultation, that people were expressing during the consultation. In terms of in terms of how sports will look at that, it'll vary sport by sport. We're encouraging sports to work through the process. Sports have to consider things like how gender affected they are, in what ways they're gender affected, and make decisions at different elements of the sport, potentially at different levels of the sport, whether they want to take a different approach in that balance, as well as considering whether there are different forms of the sport. Many governing bodies will both cover different disciplines, but will also have modified versions of sports in various forms that have emerged over a number of years, which aren't necessarily just about promoting trans inclusion, but are about generally improving inclusion overall. And just briefly on the safety element is not necessarily, is probably a small number of sports, and it's safety on the field of play around particularly collision and combat sports, where that different in physique can potentially create safety issues that need to be considered. And again, that has to be really done on a sport-by-sport basis, dependent on the scientific evidence available.
And do you have any comments on how that needs to be balanced? I mean, Malcolm's given some very sort of examples of different types of sport that may have a different attitude or may have to involve a different way because of the element of the sport they may have or the competition that they may be involved in.
Mm-hmm. I would reiterate, first of all, that there are many sports who are already managing to make that balance really very successfully and have done for quite some time. Some sports make decisions about restrictions based upon what level of competition that might be, and other sports might make those kind of decisions, based around things like access to clubs and facilities and so on. I think that our practice experience is that, the kind of queries that we get through, whether that's through training, advocacy, general queries, they're significantly more likely to have questions about how to support trans people to get the best out of sport and to get the best out of their sport, rather than having particular challenges around achieving that balance per se. And I guess I would just maybe kind of say that, although I think that we are focusing today on quite a lot of the legal mechanisms around the restriction of trans people in sport, I might just underline how important it is to also see access to sport and physical activity as a rights and fairness issue for trans people as well. And also worth remembering that trans people are already playing sport and have been. This is not a new or a recent thing. So that balance being struck is definitely something that we continue to engage with and support sports bodies on, and it's something which has been ongoing for many years.
Thank you, Convener.
Thank you. If we can now go to Fulton McGregor, please.
Thanks, Convener. And it's broadly following up Alexander's line of questioning there. You talked about the consultation for the joint guidance that was published and the responses that came in to that. I'm wondering if you can talk about what sort of response you've had since the guidance has been published. Has it sort of been on the same trends as the two trains of thought that you've already spoke about, or has there been have you had further responses that have given you cause for consideration?
So I think unsurprisingly, the guidance doesn't make everyone happy. It takes a view that governing that sports will have to come up and work on their own position, so it's also not a final statement on what actually the outcomes will be on a sport-by-sport basis. But there are not... We were never expecting everyone to be happy that sits on either side of the debate, if you like, to kind of simplify things. What I think we've been really pleased with is the response from the governing bodies of sport. They're probably our kind of key stakeholder in this. They're who the guidance is designed to support. And what we're seeing is sports being really willing to engage in thinking about this issue, thinking about how they really can open up their sport and make it more accessible to transgender people, not just around the guidance, but also I think it's important to see that there's the guidance around eligibility, but actually once sports are comfortable that they can come to a decision on that, that really helps them then look at things like culture around the sport that are actually potentially bigger barriers to transgender participation than the actual eligibility regulations themselves.
And do you find that this is something that sports bodies, you know, for different sports across the country come to you to seek advice on?
Yes, absolutely. It's the part of the reason that we looked at our... There was previous home country's guidance that dated from 2015. Part of the reason for updating the guidance was because sports were speaking to us about this issue and saying that they needed more practical guidance to support them to make decisions.
And do you feel that it's something that has increased as there's been a debate around the issue? Is it something that's always... you've always had your advice on?
Yeah, I mean, I would agree with Hugh that it's something that's not new to sport. It's been an issue for a number of years, something that sports have to consider. Probably Hugh, actually, from a Leap Sport point of view, is one of the bodies that sports would go to when they have questions around this, might be a better place to actually say whether the level of inquiries they're getting on specific issues. But on the overall, sports know that they need a policy in place around this, that they need to come to some kind of clear decisions on it, and then they need to work to improve accessibility, and that's not really changed over the years.
Thanks a lot, and thanks, Malcolm, for the nudge across to you as well.
Yeah, thank you. excuse me. So, I mean, I would certainly first of all start off by saying that there has definitely been an uptick in interest in this topic across the time of the last couple of years, alongside the time that this particular bill has been consulted on. I think that some of the reason for that is that there is some continued and often quite deliberately misleading campaigning against trans people's participation in sport. And that's just continued throughout the kind of lengthy delays that we've had as this bill has progressed. I think it's also fair to say that the new guidance, as Malcolm described, kind of looks at two sides of a debate. And that's not actually a position that we've always recognised in relation to sport. We work with sports bodies somewhere in the middle of all of that. And this topic is usually presented as either trans people currently have unrestricted access to all participation categories in sport and therefore it must stop, or that these current proposals will create a position where trans people will have unrestricted access to all categories in sport. Both of those things are clearly and demonstrably untrue. I think in relation to the release of the new guidance, we see the vast majority of trans people and athletes who haven't welcomed the guidance. They believe that the approach that it's taken and the tone that it takes is hostile to their inclusion in sport. And I think to some degree, that's not necessarily just about the guidance itself. It's about the context and the current time within which that guidance has emerged throughout this this process of consultation on the bill. Specific concerns that trans people have about that are it would lead to an increase in unwanted attention, hostility and harassment in sport, and also fears that some of the sports bodies, which they would previously have described as having their back when it comes to participation in sport, will be coming under increased pressure to review their policies and to become more restrictive in the process of doing so. And sadly, from an advocacy point of view, I would have to say that we're already seeing evidence that upholds some of those concerns. I think there are some of those immediate concerns and also lots of longer term impacts that we need to consider in relation to how the guidance is implemented within sport.
Yeah, thanks for that. Possibly just as a remark, and not anything to do with this legislation, because I think you've been quite clear that it doesn't really impact in sport, but it does sound like from what you've said there that actually trans people in sport have quite an unpredictable future, if you like, because all it would take is a change in organisation or structure or people at the top of an organisation or standing orders or whatever for there to be a significant change for their participation. But that's more a remark than anything else, Convener.
Okay, thank you. Can we go to Karen Adam next, please?
Thank you, Convener, and welcome to the panel this morning. You've given really full and comprehensive answers, to a lot of the questions already this morning. But I'd really like to ask, picking up on some of the answers you've given, and what do you consult with experts and other third sector organisations when developing and shaping your policy? And in regards to you spoke about performance measures and how testosterone levels isn't perhaps the way to go. I mean, some cisgendered women take testosterone, obviously, for medical reasons. So these kinds of measures really aren't pertinent, I suppose, to what you're looking at. So what experts, medical experts and third sector organisations do you consult with within your bodies?
So in terms of the production of the guidance, we consulted with around 300 people from about 175 organisations around the world, as well as individual participants in sport. We looked, in terms of the scientific evidence, at peer-reviewed papers, so looking at what the published evidence that is in place says. We consulted with invited into the consultation organisations that held dramatically different views on transgender participation in sport, trying to get as wide a range of views as possible into that. So that included LGBT representative organisations. It included organisations that have raised concerns about transgender participation in sport.
Thank you.
So as a charitable organisation working in the advocacy space, we don't conduct any particular research activities ourselves in relation to the science of sport. But we regularly work with sports governing bodies, both within Scotland in a UK-wide basis, and then also in the international field as well. I think at a Scotland level, it's been really important for us since the production of the Out for Sport research back in 2012 to actually come together as a sector around the sports topic, given some of the very particular areas of interest that has brought up. That's led to the creation of the National LGBTI Sports Group, which meets on a quarterly basis and has Sport Scotland, many of the other sports governing bodies, Scottish Government, ourselves, and some of the other equality organisations. And through that group, we look at emerging evidence, guidance, practice and so on, as well as sharing good practice across the sector.
That's great. I mean, thank you very much. As I've said, you have been very full and comprehensive and perhaps out the scope of what we really are scrutinising here today. So just to reiterate and re-emphasise, in terms of this bill that we're looking at right now and the simplification process for a GRC certificate, what or if any impact will there be on the sports organisations?
So again, just to reiterate from our point of view, we've been through this in some detail. We've consulted with both sports bodies and trans people and haven't been able to find any direct impacts that we think that these reforms will actually have on sport in a very specific way around the current proposals.
Thank you.
Yeah, Sport Scotland shares that analysis that there won't be any impact of the bill on sport and therefore doesn't take a position on any of the features of the bill. And for that reason, although we regularly provide evidence and submissions to calls for evidence from committees, in this case we didn't because we were so clear that there was no impact on sport.
Thank you very much. Thank you.
Okay, thank you. And Pam Gossel.
Thank you, Convener. I'd like to go back to a little bit about how it affects other countries. So I'm interested a bit more on cross-border effects that the reform of the GRA could have on participation in sporting competitions. So, for example, do you expect that moving to a system of self-declaration would conflict with the guidance set out in other countries, either in the United Kingdom or abroad? How do you see working around that? I know you've talked a lot about, obviously, Scotland here, but how do you see working in the UK and with other countries?
So our view would be the same as in Scotland, that GRC certificates are not used as part of the process that sports undertake, either at the UK, at the Scottish level or the UK level, and therefore we don't see any impact on that based on a cross-border concern.
Yeah, I support that position. I think as it currently stands in Scotland, any of the eligibility criteria within the player pathway that would take someone from national level competition to international level is done through that sports-specific criteria, which is enabled by Section 195 of the Equality Act and not in any way by the Gender Recognition Act.
Okay, thank you.
Okay, thank you very much. Pam, did you have a further question or have you covered everything?
I have covered everything I was intended to, but something, if I could have another question, that'd be great. Thanks, Convener. Hugh, I wonder if you could tell us a little bit about trans people's participation in sport, why it's important and how they interact right now with other women and other men in sport as well.
Mm-hmm. So thank you for the question, Pam. I mean, sport is not only for the privileged. I think the COVID-19 pandemic has really sharply brought into focus the importance of sport and physical activity to our mental health and our well-being. And that's absolutely no different for trans people. But also it can be a really important tool for trans people to be able to access sport and physical activity in the process of preparing for a transition or indeed going through transition. Everything from potentially preparing your body for surgery to using sport as a way to achieve that body that you want to have. It's a really important tool for all of us in that regards, but particularly so for trans people for that particular reason. I think in relation to how trans people interact with men and women on their teams as it currently stands, we find on the whole that sports clubs and people within those sports clubs are incredibly supportive of their teammates. And in actual fact, in very many cases, will go that extra length to advocate on their behalf or stand up for the inclusion of someone within their team. And that's something that we work regularly with and that we see not only, on Pride Month or indeed on particular days of the year, but right throughout the year. And whilst, again, I would say that we do recognise that there are some people with concerns, the vast majority of people take that very supportive view.
Thank you. Please.
Just very briefly, because our consultation's been touched on a couple of times, I think it's really important to say that our consultation, there was absolutely widespread support for the view that sport should be accessible for all, including to transgender people. The questions that emerged or the concerns that emerged from some people were about how that was achieved, not whether it should be achieved. And as I think I said earlier, I think there's a lot of work to do still around culture and other barriers that aren't about eligibility criteria, as well as thinking about those eligibility criteria. But making sport accessible to all is certainly something that Sport Scotland's absolutely committed to.
Thank you.
Okay, thanks everyone. That concludes the questions for this morning. Huge thanks to Hugh and to Malcolm. That concludes the public part of our meeting. We'll now move into private for the final items of our agenda. Thank you.